Hello and welcome to this edition of Education Matters. I'm your host, Joy Hoffmeister. As Superintendent of Public Instruction for Oklahoma, I am thrilled to be joining forces with OETA to visit with you about important topics and key initiatives for public education across our state. I like to say that there are two main beneficiaries of strong public education. First is the student, and second is everyone else. A strong and vibrant public education is vital for a strong and vibrant Oklahoma. And so each month, we will discuss issues at the forefront of our communities, schools, and students. One key area is life after high school. So with each passing year, workforce demands are changing, and our students will need to be equipped with the skills necessary for a successful future. We need to make sure all our students can graduate high school career ready. And that's our topic for today on Education Matters. Joining me now is Dr. Kathy Dodd. Kathy is Regional Vice President for the nonprofit Project Lead the Way. Kathy, welcome. And please tell us, what is Project Lead the Way?
Well, Project Lead the Way is a national nonprofit that is committed to providing transformative learning opportunities for students and teachers around the areas of engineering, biomedical science, and computer science. And in order to ensure that our students are prepared for those next steps after high school, we partner very intentionally with industry leaders and with university professors to ensure that the content we focus on in the classroom is the content that's most valued when students graduate.
Well, speaking of graduation, we know that it is so important that our students are prepared to hit the ground running for their next steps in learning after high school. And right now, we don't have enough of our students who are moving into either college setting or a career certification pathway. In fact, we know that by 2025, it is estimated that 77% of Oklahoma jobs will require more than a high school diploma. So I have a great interest in the work that you did in Union Public School in Tulsa, where you worked many years there and helped create the Union Collegiate Academy. Let's stop for a moment and hear what Mayor G.T. Bynum had to say.
In the 21st century, there is such a broader range of skill sets that you need. And we're moving into an era where creativity and intellectual capital are more valuable than they've ever been in our history. And so having a program at Union that is preparing high school students on a collegiate level is a tremendous step forward for us as a city in having a workforce that can help companies grow.
So, Kathy, tell me more about the Collegiate Academy.
So as a part of the district-wide strategic planning process, we placed at the center an audacious goal of graduating 100% of our students college and career ready. And we recognize that many students, though concurrent enrollment has always been an option available to them, there were barriers that kept students from experiencing that important introduction into college while they were in high school. And so in an effort to make college more accessible to students, we decided to bring, through a partnership with Tulsa Community College, those TCC professors on campus to Union High School and eliminate the barrier for transportation for students, and even purchase some of those textbooks from district resources, since those courses counted not only for college credit, but also dual credit for high school credit as well, and to enable those students to get what they needed, that introduction into college while they're still in a high school setting, and they can learn the difference in the expectations, the difference in planning, the difference in organizing their lives in order to be more successful after they enter college full time.
Well, another successful program at Union is the Career Connect program. Can you tell us a little about that and how you are meeting the needs of how many students in Union in their high school?
Well, there are 16,000 students in the entire district. About 3,600 of those students are in high school. And what we recognized is that too many of our programs were only serving a small number of students. And so in an effort to make that college and career expectation one that was universal for all students, we added some of our own programming that was focused on preparing students for that next step after high school in industry, internships, in gaining certifications while they were in high school in order to explore some of those high demand, high salary opportunities that exist for students in manufacturing, in auto technology, in teaching. We began to expand the choices that students had so that they could explore those professions as a part of their regular high school schedule.
Wow. Well, I know this must be exciting for, of course, families who are able to see their students moving into college coursework or into the career tech center where they're earning credentials even before they graduate. But let's take a moment to hear what businesses have to say about the Career Connect program.
We have really high quality students that come in that are able to do work that maybe a paid person would do. So definitely it's a benefit for us. We're also looking at it as a recruiting pool. A lot of these students want to be police officers, maybe communication officers. So if we can let them feel comfortable around this situation, then, it's kind of intimidating coming into a police department. I do a background check on them. They have to get their fingerprints done. But they're also able to do a set-along in communication so they can really see if that's what they want to do for a career.
If I could put a number of scale 1 to 10, it'd be a 10. These students have been polite. They have been just overwhelmingly nice. They are eager to learn. You put a wrench in their hand and watch them go. I mean, it's really it's that kind of concept. We want to teach them safely, and it's really, really been a win-win situation for both of us.
So many times when we talk with businesses in communities across Oklahoma, whether that's rural or in a suburban metro setting, what we hear is businesses are eager to be a part of it, but they're not quite sure how to be a part of it. We saw there are some examples in just a moment ago, but can you tell us a little bit about that response from the business community?
Sure. I think that what we realized and learned from our process with Union Career Connect is that this is not a time for schools to design yet another program and invite industry in at the end. But this is a time for us to set at the table and really plan that initiative together. And it's okay as school folks that we don't have all the answers in the beginning. That's an uncomfortable thing for us sometimes. But this is a different way of thinking about how students are spending their school day. And it requires a different way of thinking alongside business and industry in order to execute on that goal. And so my advice to people who are thinking about moving in this direction is involve business and industry early and be very responsive to what they have to say about what they want changed as far as what we've been delivering in the past.
Well, the conversation is just getting started, and we'll be back after a quick break to show you a series we do at the State Department of Education called Shaped My Life. You'll hear from a notable Oklahoma about that special teacher who truly impacted their life.
My name is Nicole Lynn. I'm an attorney and NFL sports agent based in Houston, Texas. I grew up in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I went to Booker T. Washington High School. I spent my undergraduate degree at the University of Oklahoma, and I also received my law degree at the University of Oklahoma College of Law. Teachers are instrumental portions of children's lives, and sometimes people don't understand how big of a deal a teacher is, especially in a situation where a kid like myself comes from a single-parent household. I had one teacher in particular in the second grade who was actually a librarian that took a special interest in me. Her name was Miss Terry. Miss Terry sent me home with food because I didn't have it, anything from milk to bread to snacks. She'd come and she'd bring me clothes that her granddaughter couldn't fit so that I could have warm clothes for the winter. She even gave me my very first birthday gift at 6 years old, a Jasmine doll from the movie Aladdin. Miss Terry, I don't know if you're ever gonna see this, but thank you so much for all you did and how instrumental you were in my life. Thank you for taking that special interest. You not only shaped my life, but saved my life. Teachers are truly the way of the future.
Joining us is Chelsea Hunt. Chelsea is the Career Pathway Strategy Lead at the State Department of Education. Chelsea, welcome, and tell us a little bit more about what we're doing at the state level to help better prepare our students and connect with business.
Okay. So getting businesses involved in education is a key goal for our state department. One way that we are doing that is by the initiative of individual career academic planning. Fondly, we term it ICAP. And so what ICAP is, it is a career and academic development process that helps students plan for life after high school. ICAP really is just a framework for schools. They're already doing great things, so this is just giving them a little bit more structure on how to put those things together. So what is good about ICAP is it's intentional. It's specific for our students so that they match their interests and their skills and their abilities to what they really want to do, so they're actually ready after high school. Once they graduate and walk across that stage, they're not scared to say, I don't know what I'm going to do in my life. I've got an ICAP and I know exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to career tech. I'm going to go to college. I'm going to go straight to the military or to the workforce. So that is really what ICAP is all about.
So it doesn't have to start right at the last as students or seniors. When we talk with districts, and we have many of our districts that are piloting the ICAP program before it goes statewide, and some of them are doing that at different ages. Can you describe some of those options?
Yes. So we have right now, as you mentioned, we have a pilot study that started in 2017-2018. We had 28 districts and 59 sites that participated. And then we are currently in our second year of it with 74 districts and 134 sites. And what they are doing, they got to choose, when did they want to start ICAP? Did they want to start in the 9th grade, the 5th, the 6th? So we have some who've started in middle school to really see and get ready before it comes full implementation in 2019-2020, beginning in 9th grade. So it's been really good, and we have an outside evaluator from the University of Oklahoma, and they showcase already some best practices that our districts are doing. And the first year districts, they just said, you know what, we need to begin ICAP starting at 6th grade, but also earlier than that, getting them ready.
That career cruising,
yes,
that can start in families,
yes,
even in elementary school. But we also know that it's really important for our students to have a vision for all the different opportunities, career fields that are out there. Marian Wright Edelman said, you can't be what you don't see. We know that mentoring is a key part of the successful launch for our students and bringing in business. Can you describe some of that work that you're very heavily involved in making that connection?
Yes. So right now what we are doing, we are creating some resources that are just geared towards connecting business and education partnerships. One of our resources right now is the online community platform. And through this platform, we have an opportunity for educators and business leaders to actually have open dialogue. We have a feature that is called Careers in the Classroom, and that gives a chance for an industry leader to use a webcam and talk to a whole classroom of students and just say, this is where I came, this is my interest, this is how I got to where I am now, just sharing with them. And that's good, and the students get to ask questions as well. And then another highlight of that platform is we have Oklahoma videos. So men and women from rural Oklahoma, suburban Oklahoma, and urban came together, and they graduated from Oklahoma high schools and Oklahoma colleges and universities and career techs, and they just said, look at me. So the quote you just shared, it's saying, we have some videos. Now you can see, this is an avenue for you to see that you really can be this. So that's exciting right there.
So you've mentioned technology as,
yes,
a way to kind of have a barrier that's or a hurdle that's,
yeah,
cleared. Kathy, at Union, when you were making these kinds of partnerships with business, how did mentoring factor into that?
Well, we heard loud and clear from our students that that was possibly the most powerful part of our Career Connect initiative. They appreciated all the content that they learned, but they also appreciated the deep investment that these industry professionals made in their lives. And that's where they learned so many of the professional behaviors, something we used to call soft skills, but are so critical that we changed the terminology because they are the most essential skills that help students be successful after they leave high school.
Wow, that is exciting. And we know that schools are doing this in different ways that are a part of the pilot. And I'd like us to look at Mustang Senior Conference event that they do as they prepare their students before they graduate.
I think it's really important to know what you're going to do, know where you're going to go, have a plan.
Mustang Public Schools is one of several districts across the state offering a taste of adulthood to their senior class.
And we spend your whole educational career telling you what we think you need to know, asking you to raise your hand to go to the bathroom, asking you to follow a set of rules. But when you walk across the stage on May 17th, the world is yours. And we hope we've done a really good job at preparing you. And so today is allowing you the opportunity to maybe find out some things you didn't know.
Like the dangers of renting an apartment.
Read the lease before you get into signing a contract.
And how to ace that first interview.
And I will look at you when you're asking me the question, but do I just stare you down in my response?
The Mustang Senior Conference is designed to give students the freedom to find their own path. For some, it's simply reinforcing a path they've already chosen.
My last class I just went to was the Med Careers, and I learned so much.
But for others, the conference is opening their eyes to careers they never imagined.
You will not be certified as a firefighter unless you can don your gear from head to toe in 60 seconds or less.
Mustang Public Schools is currently in its second year of a pilot program called ICAP, Individual Career Academic Planning. The program will be implemented statewide starting in the 2019 school year.
So this is like our next step in the ICAP process. It's what's the next step for seniors, but it's also what's the next step for a school in helping have that vision to prepare our students to be ready for life.
The idea is catching on. Other districts are learning from Mustang while preparing for senior conferences of their own.
We want our students to be excited about learning about careers and college and just adulting and life after high school.
No matter what you've done before now, no matter if you're behind in credits, no matter if you've made some bad decisions, no matter if you think you can't get where you need to be, you can.
After a day completely geared toward them.
I've wasted a lot of my life trying to be somebody else and not myself.
These students are a step closer to the future they want.
Sir, I wish every school in Oklahoma or really in the United States got the opportunity like we do.
Our group just keeps growing. With us now is Melanie Howe, superintendent of Duncan Public Schools. Duncan is in the second year of the three-year ICAP pilot study. So welcome, Melanie, and please tell us some of the things that you have found in a rural school district of Duncan as you have worked to prepare your students for life after high school.
Our job is to maximize opportunities for our students, and that's not just for what happens after they leave our doors, but many years into the future. We want to make sure they're productive citizens. And whether our students are going on to college or whether they're planning to work in the local community in a career, we want them to be fully prepared. And in my rural community of Duncan, for us, that meant that we were interested early on in career pathways. We were doing career pathways beginning in the early 2000s, and when I became superintendent of Duncan 4 years ago, we were looking at ways to expand that programming, Career Pathways 2.0, and we talked a lot about what that would be for our students.
So you spoke about these career pathways. What does that mean for our viewers at home that may not be a part of this in their school, this is a new term for them?
What we're trying to do for students is match their aspirations with their potential and match them with the 16 career clusters. The ICAP program, which we're a pilot for ICAP, helps us do that. But we're also building awareness early on for students. We have community members that represent various careers around the community that will come in and speak to students as early as pre-K and provide that exposure to them about what are the opportunities that are out there for them after they graduate from high school.
So you mentioned career clusters. I have to ask Chelsea, would you describe what that means when we are talking about those career fields or what we mean in reference to a career cluster?
Okay. So what we have a little state map that kind of denotes this, and it starts with the 6 career fields, which break down into the 16 career clusters. And so that's just a little bit more extensive of what relates to a field. So say example, you have the field of health sciences, and then you break that down into a career cluster, and it's nursing, maybe that's an example of it. So, and then that breaks down into programs of study, which are 79. So it's just a stair step down, and that's kind of the difference between.
Very, very good. So as you think about this from a rural perspective, and we know that we have hundreds of school districts that are in a rural setting in Oklahoma, what's some advice that you would give those schools that are just thinking about how do we get this started and how do we make sure that our kids are making those connections with business?
I think it's important in rural communities to be seen as a thriving community and a community that can attract jobs and industry to your area or to your region. And for us, it was about making sure that we listened to our members of business and industry and made sure that we were matching the skills that they felt they needed to the skills that we were teaching our students. And I would recommend working with your local Economic Development Foundation. They have been a tremendous partner for us in Duncan, and they have helped us meet with industry partners. In fact, we have meetings scheduled for next week to make sure that the things that we're doing are working.
And that those are meaningful. But what you've shown is that this can be done regardless where a school is located.
Yes.
But there are new challenges depending on your setting and those connections, as we heard earlier from Kathy. So Kathy, you've been doing this for probably the longest period of time here at the table. What would be one of those barriers that you had to clear when you first started thinking about taking on such a huge project of connecting our students with those career fields that we know await them?
Sure, we got started with manufacturing. We had a willing partner in APSCO and in Bama Companies to be that pioneer in the process with us, to think about how do we get students from school, since this is occurring during the regular school day, from school to the industry floor, to the manufacturing facility, and then back to complete their school day. And so thinking strategically about transportation barriers, mm-hmm. which get a little bit more complicated as districts are larger, that is one advantage that, mm-hmm. that you have in a more rural community. You're closer to your business and industry, but therefore you also mm-hmm. may have fewer industries to choose from. So I think the most important thing is start with one willing partner and think through that process with them, and then just systematically start eliminating those barriers that you're facing.
That's excellent. Chelsea, you have another thought we discussed that?
I did. So transportation is one of the barriers to access. One other thing that we've come to realize is insurance and liability. And so it is, as you mentioned earlier, the workforce skills gap. That is something vital about business and education partnerships. We can come together and really have a discussion of how do we start providing insurance and liability for our students so that they can get internships and actually see what your facility is and get that mentorship again, as we mentioned earlier. So, yes.
Well, and we want to be able to give students then the course credit mm-hmm. for that opportunity. And that brings us right back to what this is all about, and it's about students. I'm curious, Melanie, when you share about what this is like in your school, what do the students have to say?
Our students are thrilled that we have an internship program as well. We went to Union Schools and looked at their Career Connect program, brought it back home, and tailored it for our community needs. We have a teacher that is a coordinator for that effort, and she makes sure that our students take time to reflect on what they're learning out in the field. They come back to the classroom once a week. Our students love the program, and some of our students have received jobs right out of high school because of the program, and we even have a few students that are receiving scholarships because of the connections that they've made with businesses in our community. So our students are thrilled because they get to get out there, they get to get their hands dirty, be involved, and even if they decide that the internship that they participated in isn't a career that they want to choose, they still believe it was a valuable experience because of the connections that they've made in the community and the relationships that they've built.
It's so exciting to hear about how students really have a jump start on that career cruising, learning about what's required when they move into the field of work, but also starting to make those business mm-hmm. connections. Those are relationships that they'll be able to draw on in the future, which is really exciting when we hear that. Kathy, as you think about someone who is sitting at home watching this and thinking about being engaged, what is some advice for the school aspect of getting started in this?
I think just being willing to sit down with the partner, like I said, early on in the process, not trying to think it all out and then go to business and industry with the plan, but making business and industry an integral part of that from the beginning. Because remember, the reason we're doing this approach is because the ways we used to do it didn't work. It didn't serve students' needs. It didn't fill these important workforce gaps that we see in our local economies and in our state. So it's critical that we involve business early on.
Well, thank you so much, both, all of three of you, Melanie, Chelsea, and Kathy, for joining us. We know that many people want to get involved. And if you want to get involved in your community or with your local school district, the opportunities are endless. Send us an email at educationmatters@sde.ok.gov. We'll get you connected. You can also go to our website at sde.ok.gov and search new skills for youth. Now, my school spotlight this month, Enid High School. I want to give a shout out to the high school art students who turned something not so pretty into a bona fide work of art. To encourage optimism and a can-do attitude, the art students turned a temporary drywall into a mural, reinforcing the character-building themes they demonstrate at their school: resilience, honesty, empathy, and integrity, just to name a few. It's a lovely work of art and job well done, Enid High School. That does it for us today. We'll see you back here next time for more Education Matters.